Oh, hi. In this video, I'm going to talk about this very important tool in quantum mechanics, the Fermi Golden Rule. Now, what this formula tells you, it's this formula right here, is what the probability is of a quantum system that starts in a certain energy state to jump to another certain energy state after a certain amount of time t. Now, this rule is extremely important because it allows you to calculate the rate of transition from one state to another in, say, atomic physics or nuclear physics. In other words, decay rates of radioactive nuclei, for instance, or the jumping of electrons from one shell to another in atomic physics. So it's extremely important. It's so important that Enrico Fermi, the scientist, when he saw this rule, named it the Golden Rule. And ever since then, it's been known as the Fermi Golden Rule. Now, it wasn't Fermi who actually devised this rule, who calculated it from basic quantum mechanical postulates. That was Dirac who did that. But it was Fermi who recognized how important it was, and that's why he called it the Fermi Golden Rule. Now, my plan in this video is to go through the physics of the formula, as in what it actually teaches you and how you can apply it. Then I'm going to actually derive it from scratch, and in order to do so, I have to go back to basic postulates of quantum mechanics to see what we're working with. And then we're going to do the whole calculation, end up with this rule right here. The applications I will save for another video. My endpoint is going to be this formula and what it means. Now, to start with that last part, what it exactly means, let's look at the situation. In quantum mechanics, what you typically have is a piece of nature, and for convenience sake, let's say it's an atom or so, an electron in an atom. And this piece of nature has a certain definitive beginning state. In other words, at the beginning of the situation, your system is in this beginning state that we call psi I. I stands for initial. Now, we're going to take this as an eigenstate of energy. And an eigenstate of energy means, in a certain way, that it will stay there. At the moment that it's in this state, it will try to stay there indefinitely. Unless, of course, something pushes your state into another state. So something happens that makes your initial state go to a final state. And to take our definitive example, you could, for instance, say, have an electron in one of the orbits and something pushes it to one of the other orbits. Now, the pushing has to be done by something, and that pushing is done by an operator in our formalism that I will call, for reasons that will become apparent later, it is called H1, and the hat means that it's an operator. So this is the situation. A piece of nature, say an electron in an atom, it's in one shell, something pushes the electron out and it will jump to another shell. What this formula tells you is what the probability is of this having happened after a certain amount of time. So there's that. You can already see by the formula that it should be something like this, because what you see here is your initial state, and it's made into a bracket with the final state with this operator in between. And people who read quantum mechanics know that what it says here really is exactly, or almost exactly, what I say that it is, namely the probability of this thing operating on the initial state giving you back that final state. It just so happens that there's time factors involved, and that's given by this sine squared over here. It has this piece of time in there. So this formula in a moment will tell us not just what the probability is of starting here and ending up there because of the pushing of H1, but what the probability is at a certain time. And again, for atomic and nuclear physicists, is interesting because if you would divide this by t, the probability per unit time, it's a measure of the rate at which this happens. And in people in nuclear physics, say, are interested in rates because this is what they measure. They take a nucleus, it starts out in this state, at some point it will end up in that state and will send out particles as they do. That's radioactivity. How often does that happen? That's a measure of the half-life or the decay rate. And this, of course, what you measure in the laboratory. So the Fermi Golden Rule is one way of connecting what you measure in your laboratory, say in nuclear physics, to what happens on a quantum mechanical level. So that's what the Golden Rule tells you. Now, in order to do derivation of this situation, we have to go back to basic postulates of quantum mechanics. Now, quantum mechanics can be built up in many ways, but the way that I'm going to build it up is the way that Dirac built it up. Now, I'm not going to derive all the resulting conclusions from this, just going to give you the postulates and the parts that we need to do this derivation. Quantum mechanics in the Dirac formalism tells you the following. If you have a piece of nature, regardless of what it is, all the information of that piece of nature is contained within this object that we call a ket, or a state function. This is a ket. It It contains all the information of your piece of quantum mechanics, your piece of nature. From a cat, you can make this other object, this thing, it's called a bra, and it's just defined as the cat complex conjugate, or Hermitian conjugate if it happens to be a vector, but forget about those technical details. So this is our first postulate, that all information can be contained within these things called cats, and in their corresponding bras. And of course, people in the know already know that bra and cat in a moment will turn into something that is called a bracket, that also has a physical meaning, but we'll get there. So that's one postulate. Now, if you have all this information contained within this cat, how do you get numbers out? Because of course, in experiments, we want to know what numbers are so we can compare them to what the theory says. And the idea is this, that there are special cats, and those I will label with an extra index n. There are special cats that have the following property, that if you try to measure some observable that we call A, could be energy, could be momentum, could be angular momentum, could be magnetic field, whatever, some observable that we designate by this letter A, it's an operator, that's why it has a hat. And there are special cats for each operator that has the following property. If you do this operator on this cat, it will give you back the same cat, but with a number in front that I call alpha. This is not trivial. Usually what you have is you have a cat and you let an operator operate on it. What it will give you back is a different cat. Which is another way of saying that if you have a piece of nature and you try to measure something on it, you will disturb the system, and what you get back is a different system. Not so in this case. These special cats that are labeled with the little n's have the special property. If you measure this thing, you will get back the exact same situation that you started out with. But mathematically speaking, you get a number back, this number here. This thing, in mathematics you will call this the eigenvalue. This eigenvalue is exactly the value that you would measure if you actually did the experiment. So if you have a piece of quantum mechanics that is already in this special state, this special cat, and you then measure this number, you try to measure this observable, then this number will actually come flying out of your experiment. Now, these special cats that have this property are called eigencats. This whole equation is called an eigenvalue equation because it's very analogous to something that you see in linear algebra. If you have a vector and you let a matrix, an operator, operate on it, what you will get back is a different vector, has a different direction, has a different magnitude. But there are some special vectors that if you let a matrix operate on it, you will get back the exact same vector. It's called an eigenvalue equation, an eigenvector in linear algebra. It's exactly the same structure. You end up with it, you start with a piece of nature, you do something to it, what you get back is the same piece of nature but with a number in front. This number is what you would measure if you actually did the experiment. But that means that this eigenvalue equation has a very interesting physical property, and that is that if your system happens to be in an eigenstate, or an eigencat, it's the same word for the, it's a different word for the same thing. If your system happens to be in an eigencat, you know with 100% certainty what the outcome is going to be if you do this measurement. It's always going to be this eigenvalue. This is uncommon in quantum mechanics, but because typically quantum mechanics tells you if you do a measurement, you're not certain what number will come flying out of your measurement. What comes out is usually a discrete spectrum of possible outcomes, and you don't know which number is actually going to come out. Now, not if the system happens to start out in an eigencat, because in that case you know with 100% certainty that this value will come flying out of your measurement, the eigenvalue. So that's my second postulate, that quantum mechanics operates in that way. Now, of course, this only holds for these special cats that we call eigencats. Generally speaking, your system, your piece of nature, will not start out in an eigencat. It will start out in this general cat. And just out of notation, let me just say every time that I don't write an n underneath my size, in that case I mean a general cat, a not eigenstate. And when it does have an n, I mean an eigenstate. Now, generally speaking, a piece of nature will not be in an eigenstate or an eigencat. So that means that it will be in this general state. And then my next postulate tells us that you can always write your general state as a sum of eigenstates. And that's what I'm doing right now. So say that you have, say 12 or so, different eigenstates belonging to this operator, then you can write the general state as a linear combination of these 12 eigenstates of the operator A. That you can do this is one of my postulates. Now, of course, it takes an enormous amount of space if you have to write down all 12 eigenstates in this summation all the time. So, of course, we're going to use a summation symbol to abbreviate it. So it's going to look like this. A sum over eigenstates. Now, each eigenstate will weigh in a different manner. So generally, each eigenstate comes with a number in front, a complex number, an, I'm going to call these. What an really tells you is how much of a certain eigenstate is in my general state. Or in other words, say that I take the number a5, and a5 happens to be a big number, then what I'm really saying is that the eigenstate psi5 is well represented in my general state. My general piece of nature very much looks like as if it's in psi5 state. It's not completely, because a5 is going to be a big number, it's also going to be other numbers, it's a linear combination, but this really is what it tells you. But that gives us an important physical interpretation of what an means. Because if a5 happens to be a big number, which is another way of saying that psi5 is well represented in my general state, then measuring this observable on my general state is very likely to give back the eigenvalue alpha5 that belongs to this eigenstate 5. Right? I mean, the more a certain eigenstate 5 is represented in my general state, the bigger the chances are that my measurement will give me back the eigenvalue of that state. So this thing is related to the probability of finding a certain eigenvalue. And in fact, and this is something, it's not a postulate, you can derive it from what we have already on the board, you can show, and I'm going to show this without any proof, I have another video on that, is that this number, if you take an and you modulo square it, is the probability, the percentage probability, that if you measure the observable big A on my general state, will give me the experimental value alpha 5, the eigenvalue, or not 5, n, will give me the eigenvalue alpha n that belongs to the nth eigenstate. Because the probability of measuring A on this psi will give back alpha n as value. Again, going from here to here, it's an exercise in mathematics that you can derive if you understand these postulates well. And it's going to be important for our Fermi-Gould rule, so this is why I emphasize it right now. There's one fourth postulate that we're also going to use in our derivation of the Fermi-Gould rule, and that is the following. Namely, if you have two eigenstates, say psi n, and you have psi m, another eigenstate, belonging to the same operator, then you can make this thing out of it. You can make psi m the cat into its bra, and then you place the bra against the cat, you get this thing a bracket, and what comes out is some number. Now, my fourth postulate is that you can normalize these numbers. What I mean by this is that the outcome of this bracket, this number, is going to be Kronecker delta nm. What that means is that if m happens to be the same eigenstate as n, or in other words, m equals n, then the number that comes out is 1, is unity. Or if n does not equal m, there are different eigenstates, then the number that comes out is 0. Now, both the 0 outcome and the 1 outcome are both encapsulated in this Kronecker delta right here, and so you normalize these things. Now, going back to the analogy with linear algebra, this is also what you have in linear algebra, that if you have two vectors, two arrows, then you can find a number of arrows that have this property that if they're orthogonal to each other, so with a 90-degree angle, that this thing becomes zero. It will be an inner product. In vectors, it will be x inner product y equals 0, and x inner product with itself becomes unity. X and x themselves are unity. So again, it's very analogous to what you see in linear algebra. In linear algebra, this will be an inner product, this dot product here. In quantum mechanics, it's this more complicated thing that we call a bracket, this abstract thing. So this is all that we need from basic quantum mechanics. Now let's go to the derivation of the Fermi golden rule. That was a jump cut. We're going to derive the Fermi golden rule using our postulates of quantum mechanics over there. Now, in order to make the connection very explicit, let me just recap what it says here. The Fermi golden rule said that at the start of things, you have a piece of nature, and by start mean at t equals zero. At the start of things, this piece of nature is in this particular eigenstate of energy. From our second postulate here, that means that if we were to take a measurement of the energy of the initial situation, we will know with 100% certainty what the energy value is going to be, EI. Of course, it doesn't stay there. We already discussed that this operator, this one here, is going to push out our system from this state to another state. And this final state we called psi f. So that is at some later time, t bigger than zero. And because this is also an eigenstate of the energy operator, we also know with 100% certainty what the value is going to be of that energy. It's going to be EF. Again, this is this second postulate right here of quantum mechanics. So there's that. So this is what happens. Here's an interesting comment before I do the actual derivation. You can see that you have a definitive initial energy, you have a definitive final energy, and there's a difference between these two numbers. The difference, EI minus EF, is energy lost or gained when you went from here to there. If this were classical physics, that would be a problem, because in classical physics you're not allowed to break the conservation of energy. Now, this is not classical physics, it's quantum physics, and in quantum physics you are free to break the law of energy conservation by Heisenberg's uncertainty relation, because that tells you that the amount of energy has a certain freedom in there, some uncertainty. And you're allowed to break the conservation of energy as long as it doesn't take too long. So the fact that this is not equal zero is not a problem in quantum mechanics. You're allowed to do that by uncertainty relation by Heisenberg. Now, for historical reasons, people write this change in energy divided by h bar as a frequency. It's just Planck's law, yes? If you have energy and you would like to write it as a frequency, you just divide it by h bar. So that would be the energy of a photon. Now, there's no photon per se in this situation. So what it really says here is that if this amount of energy, this energy change, would be carried away by a photon, then that photon would have this energy. There's no energy being carried away. There's no photon in this process. It's just another way of saying there's an energy difference. Let's write it as a hypothetical, or excuse me, the frequency of some hypothetical photon that's being sent out. Now, look at the formula, the Fermi golden rule that we're going to derive in a second. You can see that this energy difference is built in. It's in the sine squared, and it's in the denominator here. Sine squared, don't worry about it too much, because the sine squared can only go between zero and unity anyway. But this denominator tells you that if you make the energy difference a big number, the denominator is that energy difference squared, becomes an even bigger number. You divide by something very big, becomes very small. In other words, it says that if you want to break the conservation of energy, then the chances of this process happening become smaller and smaller. The more you break conservation of energy, the smaller the probability is of this jump having happened. So that's built in. You can already see that Heisenberg is allowed, just by the fact that there is an energy difference to start out with, but is only allowed for small amounts of breaking of the conservation of energy. So it's nicely built in there. Okay, now let's do the actual derivation of the Fermi golden rule. Again, we're going to start in an initial state psi I, and we're wondering what will happen to that state as time progresses. We're going to look at the dynamics of the state. Now, in quantum mechanics, every time that you want to know how states evolve in time, you just have to solve one equation, it's the Schrödinger equation. The change in time of a state is always given by the Schrödinger equation. The Schrödinger equation is the Hamiltonian, operating on your state, and it gives you back the time evolution, time derivative of your state. This is a differential equation. If you solve this differential equation, given your H, your Hamiltonian operator, you know how this state will evolve in time. Now we have a situation like this because we have a situation that changes in time. Our Hamiltonian here consists of the Hamiltonian that tries to keep everything in place, right? This thing that gives everything its definitive energy, plus a contribution that tries to push everything away from this definitive energy, and that contribution is exactly that thing, this operator here, the thing that tries to push your system from state I to state F. So our Hamiltonian is going to be this combination of these two things. I put a little epsilon in front of my perturbing, as it's officially called, my perturbing Hamiltonian. And epsilon is just another way of saying that this contribution is going to be very small compared to the big contribution. The pushing from your initial state to the final state is only a small push. That's what the epsilon tells you. It's a bookkeeping device. Keeps track of which parts are small, which parts are not small. Everything that has an epsilon in front of it means it's a small contribution. So that's our Hamiltonian here. Now, the state of my situation is, well, at t is zero, it's the initial state psi I. At a later time, it's going to be some other state. I don't know what the other state is going to be, but one thing I do know, and that's postulate number three there, you can always write this general state at t is not zero as a linear combination of eigenstates. That's exactly the third postulate. The third postulate over there had the coefficients labeled as A. I label now as C. That's, of course, just a matter of notation. So we know that we can always write this general state as this thing right here. But we know a little bit more about our state of our situation. We know that at t is zero, this general state should just equal psi I, right? At t is zero, everything starts out with in the eigenstate psi I. So what we have to do in order to build that in, that boundary condition, is choose our Cn's appropriately. We have to choose our Cn in such a way that at t equals zero, we get indeed out psi I. And the way to do that is to say, well, you know what, Cn, if you would evaluate it at t is zero, then at t is zero, it's going to be a Kronecker delta In. My claim is that if you make this assumption, then you build in at t is zero, this state will just be psi I. Let's check that for a second. So we're going to take our general state, I'm going to evaluate it at t is zero. Then this part tells you this is a linear combination, but you have to calculate it at t is zero. Because of my Kronecker here, this part becomes a Kronecker. So they get a summation over a Kronecker psi n. There you go. And of course, a Kronecker and a summation have this very nice property with each other. Every time that n does not equal I, this contribution, that term in my summation will be zero. So of all these terms in the summation, all of them will be zero, except that one term where n equals I. So it becomes 0 plus 0 plus 0 plus 0 plus one contribution, namely when n equals I. And that's exactly what I wanted to build in, that at t is zero, my general state is going to be the initial state. And the only thing that I have to do to build that in is choose my Cn in this way. So that's nice. This is what we're going to build in. Now the following is going on. This only applies at t is zero. At some later time, my state is not going to be in psi I anymore. It's going to be in a different state. So if t equals not zero, I can't just put a Kronecker in, I have to do something else. And the idea that we're going to do is the following. We're going to say, you know what? For time does not equal zero, we're going to say the Cn is still that Kronecker delta plus a small perturbation. This thing right here. We saw that this psi in makes sure that at t equals zero, what you get out is psi I. At a later time, you will not stay in Psi I anymore, and that's exactly what this contribution does. It does the pushing. It tells the thing to not stay in Psi I. So that should be okay. And because we know that the pushing is being done by this operator that is small, that's why the epsilon was there, we know that this pushing away from Kronecker is also going to be small. This is why the thing also has an epsilon in front. So there's that. At this moment, I really haven't done anything yet. I just said I want the time evolution Schrödinger equation. I know what my Hamiltonian is going to be. It's going to be this thing that tries to keep everything in place, plus something that tries to push everything away. And because my third postulate, I know that my general solution can be written as this thing or that thing. And to make sure that it goes back to psi I at t0, I put the Kronecker in. Oh, and there's another condition, by the way. The Kronecker already makes sure that the t is 0, this thing goes to psi I. But this thing then should have no contribution at t is 0. So at t0, that thing should be 0. Going to be important later. We're going to have to build that in explicitly. All right, so this is what we're going to do mathematically. Here's the plan. Schrödinger equation, general state. Let's write this general state exactly how we now said that we're going to write it, as such. Cn. So I'm really just taking the Schrödinger equation and putting in my linear combination here. In plus epsilon Cn. There you go. Plug everything in. At this moment, everything is still exact. I haven't made any approximations. I just took the Schrödinger equation, rewrote my Hamiltonian, and I rewrote my solution. No assumptions, no approximations just yet. Here's where the approximation starts. If I multiply this out, the left-hand side of the Schrödinger equation, I will get some terms that do not contain any epsilons. This part, working on that part, for instance, will give me something that has no epsilons in there. But there will also be terms that do have epsilons. For instance, this part, working on that part, will give me back a part that has one epsilon in there. I will also get contributions that have epsilon squared in there. This one operating on that one will give me a term that has an epsilon squared. But the epsilons were small numbers. And a small number squared is even smaller. We're going to decide to throw everything away that is of order epsilon squared. That is, we're going to say, well, that's such a small number, we might as well neglect it altogether. This is where approximations start. At the moment that we're going to throw out terms in our equation, we know we make approximations, but it's fine. As long as epsilon is a small number, or in other words, when the perturbation is only small, the pushing away from your initial state is only a small perturbation, then it's okay to throw away everything that is epsilon squared. It's an approximation, but the smaller epsilon is, the smaller the perturbation, the better it works. So we're going to throw away everything that is epsilon squared. Now, just as an overview, what we will have here for in a moment is that if we write then this out, we will have terms with no epsilons, we have terms with single epsilons. All the epsilon squares are thrown away at that point. That will give us a couple of differential equations. We're going to collect all the terms that have no epsilons in there. That gives us this one equation that we can solve. And we can solve it, find the solution. We can also collect all the terms that have only one epsilon in there, which gives us another differential equation that we can also solve. So we're going to split this part up, this Schrödinger equation, into parts that have epsilons and parts that have no epsilons. The differential equations, we're going to solve them both. It will turn out that the differential equation that has epsilons in there will be a differential equation for these Cn's, Cn bars. Here's where the Fermi-Golden rule is. Cn bar modulo square is going to be exactly this number. How do I know that? Well, in the same way that I know it in a general linear combination of things. We just discussed that if you take this coefficient, you take this modulo square, it's the probability that if you measure on this general state, you will find it in this eigenstate. That's what this number modulo square meant. That's exactly the same situation as we have here. Because Cn bar is the coefficient of this eigenstate. In other words, Cn squared modulo squared, Cn bar modulo squared, will give us the probability that if I measure on my general state, it will be in this final state. Let me make that explicit. Cn modulo squared is the probability that measuring on my general state will give the eigenstate this one. So this conclusion follows directly from my postulates of quantum mechanics. Now parse this for a second. Probability measuring on this thing will give me that state, but that's exactly that number, right? This is the probability of starting in a state ending up in this final state. That is exactly this number. Sure, I mean, of course, you would have to call this f, final state, but apart from that notation, it's exactly the same physical interpretation. So here's the plan. We're going to take this thing, split it up in the epsilon parts and the non-epsilon parts. The epsilon parts will be a differential equation for c bar. Once then we're going to solve the differential equation, find c bar, take its modulo square, and we have exactly that number. And then we have Fermi golden rule. That's the idea. So, in order to do so, split up the differential equation. I'm going to make one modification to the equation. That is the following. All this time I've been saying that this energy operator operating on its eigenstate will give you back this one here. That's that second postulate over there. That's true, but we have a small amount of freedom to add something to this. You can add a complex phase to everything. The Schrödinger equation tells you that if this thing only depends on space and it does not depend on time, then the time evolution of your solution is always written as exactly this, as this complex phase. So I'm going to assume for the rest of the calculation that this energy operator only depends on space. And as a result, I know that I can just multiply everything by this number here, that the time evolution is given by this complex phase over here. If I do that, again, it's perfectly allowed. If I do that, my Schrödinger equation gets a somewhat different form, but not too different. I'm going to write it down here, keep it for the rest of the calculation, and have the rest of the board free. My Schrödinger equation will now finally get this final form. There we go. Epsilon Cn psi n e. It's just exactly the same Schrödinger equation with this complex phase now built in. In case you're wondering if I'm just fully free to do this, yes, it's mathematically allowed, but it's also physically allowed. And by physically allowed, I mean that ultimately, if you have one of these eigenstates and you want to turn it into physics, what you have to do is make a bracket. And if you make a bracket out of it, that means that you have to multiply it by its complex conjugate. In other words, this complex power multiplies by complex conjugate will just give you the order unity, give you back the number one. Long way of saying that adding this complex phase to everything will not change any physical information, because physically, when you take the modulo squared, this thing cancels out anyway. So it's mathematically allowed by the fact that this operator only depends on space, and it's physically allowed because it doesn't change any of your physical measurements. So this is the Schrödinger equation that we're going to work with. All right, let's make some space. Talked enough about how we're going to do it. Let us actually do it. Again, what I'm going to do, I'm going to write out the differential equation that does not depend on epsilon. So all parts that go with epsilon to the power zero, in other words, to the power unity, the outcome is unity. I'm going to write down the differential equation. We're going to solve it. Let's do it now. Multiply this out. Only take the parts that have no epsilons in there. So that's this. And n h bar. Left-hand side, the only part that will give me a term that is no epsilons in there is when I multiply this one and that one. So that's what I wrote down there. Left-hand side, the only part that will have no epsilons in there is when I multiply this one with that one. So let's write that down as well. DDT, summation, Kronecker, IN. So here's a differential equation for all parts that have no epsilons in there. Now we can already immediately solve it. It's a differential equation, yes, you have time derivatives, such and such. Unfortunately, this thing already solves itself. Let's clean up a little bit. This part, again, is a summation with a Kronecker delta. And summation Kronecker deltas, the only thing that happens is that you end up with that n value that equals I. So this will just give you this. So there's that. By the way, the same thing happens on the other side. Because there too you have a summation with a Kronecker. So it just selects out all the terms where n equals I, so you have this. We now got rid of the summations. Now, something interesting happens here. You have this operator operating this eigenstate. But we knew that this thing is an eigenstate of that operator. And by our postulate over here, that will give us back with 100% certainty the value of the energy, which is energy I. I'm just applying here now that this operator operating on that thing is just an eigenvalue equation. It gives you just back the same state, the same ket, but with its eigenvalue, and the eigenvalue is the energy, which is EI. So here's some more cleaning up. Now, this is as much cleaning up as I can do on the left-hand side of things. The right-hand side has a derivative. Now, the derivative with respect to time will only work on the complex phase here. It won't work on this one, the psi i's. If you recall, I assumed that these do not depend on time. And as a result, the eigenstates, psi I, will also not depend on time. So this thing is independent of time. It doesn't feel the derivative. The derivative will only operate on the complex phase over there. Now, let's write down that derivative. Just brings down an E. Oh, this should have been an I all this time. There you go. Here's what I did, the derivative, the derivation. Clean up a little bit. There's an I, there's a minus I. Those two cancel each other out, gives you exactly unity. There's an H bar below, H bar upstairs. They cancel each other out, and the only thing that remains is this. Now, just a second ago, I said we're going to write down all the terms that have no epsilons in there. It gives you a differential equation. We're going to solve it. We don't have to solve it. It's already been solved. Look at this. We took all the epsilon-less parts out. We did some cleaning up, and we find that left-hand side already equals right-hand side. It's exactly the same thing. So this part is already solved by itself. We don't have to worry about it. It's already been done. So there's that. Now let's go to the epsilon, to the first part. All right, so all epsilon to the power zero, the non-epsilon parts, have already been taken care of. They solved themselves. That's nice. Back to the Schrödinger equation, let's single out all the terms that go with one epsilon. Here's one, H0, and this one will give us this. Give us something with an epsilon, Cn bar, oh, I'm forgetting the summation here, excuse me. Cn bar, psi n. Alright, so that's when you let this thing operate on that thing. There's another epsilon in there, and that is when this epsilon goes with this Kronecker. So let's give us another one. Epsilon, H1, N, Kronecker, IN. Psi N. There's that. That's left-hand side. Let's go to right-hand side. Well, there's a derivative here. And the derivative, of course, will do nothing to the Kronecker here, as stated before, because these are eigenstates of a operator that does not depend on space, not depend on time. This will also not depend on time. So the only thing that this thing will operate on is going to be on this complex phase and on this Cn's, because those are time-dependent functions. So let's write out that. IH bar, derivative, we'll work on everything with an epsilon, this one and that one. Then the product rule of differentiation gives me that I would have to write down Cn. Put a little dot on top of the bar, that means time derivative. And then leave everything else intact. I'm just applying the product rule of differentiation now. There you go. Plus, again, still using the product rule here, taking the derivative of this part and leave the rest intact. So that will give us this. H bar. All right. Oh, and there's of course an epsilon here, and there's an epsilon over there. There you go. Here's everything. This is what we did. Now, it looks complicated, and maybe it is, but a lot of these terms actually are going to cancel each other out in a very good way. Let's first look at this term that has a Kronecker delta here. Now, that thing will again single out every term where n equals I. So it's going to be a little bit messy, but I'm going to write it here. It just means that this thing will get rid of its summation. We can single out this one state that has this thing in it, and all n's have now been turned into i's. There you go. There's that. Okay, that's a little bit of cleaning up that happened right there. Okay, so there's that. Well, something interesting happens here as well, because this h is going to operate on everything here, but we already stated h, 0, only depends on space. So it won't do anything with the cn's, because those only depend on time. So this h, 0 will only work on psi n, and psi n is an eigenstate. And we know from this postulate, if you let the eigenstate, the operator work on its eigenstate, it will give you back the same eigenstate with the energy value in front. So this thing applied here, again, it's going to be a little bit messy if we're going to write it down, but it will just give us back exactly the same thing, but with the energy value in front. So now we get this. So a lot of cleaning up going on. The Kronecker delta cleaned up a little bit, and the fact that these are eigenstates also cleaned up a little bit. And now we are here. Okay. But check out what happens here. At the right-hand side, we have this complicated expression, but if you clean that up a little bit, you can see there's an h-bar that cancels this h-bar, there's a minus I, cancels that I, this gives you an en. And if you look through all the cancellations, all the factors, then this thing is exactly that thing. It's the same thing. And it's on both sides of the equation, so you can just cross them out. And after all this cleaning up, you only end up with a very simple expression. And that's this one. All the terms that remain. So this whole differential equation that has terms that only contain epsilons has now been reduced to something that looks remarkably simple. In fact, I'm going to erase the rest because I'm not going to need it anymore. We have a very simple differential equation left, which is this one right here. Now, as promised, what we're looking for are expressions for the Cn's, because the Cn's modulo square is exactly the probability of having gone from one state to the other. So this differential equation, what we're going to do, we're going to peel out an expression for Cn. Now, fortunately, there's only a Cn bar dot in there, the time derivative of that thing. So we'll go in two steps. We're first going to get out cn dot. Once we have cn dot and a full expression for that one, we're going to integrate it over time, and what we get then is cn itself. Now, how do we get cn dot out? That is actually not that difficult, because we have another postulate, postulate number 4. If you take an eigenstate and you make a bracket out of it with another eigenstate, it will give you back a Kronecker delta. So if we're going to make a bracket out of this thing and that thing, if you do it on the left-hand side, you have to do it on the right-hand side too, make a bracket on both sides, then underneath this summation, you will get one of these Kronekkers, and the Kronecker will cancel the summation, and you get an expression for Cn dot. That's the idea. So I'm going to take left-hand side and right-hand side, and I'm going to bracket it with another eigenstate, psi f. Again, fully allowed to do that as long as I do it on both sides, that I'm doing now. There you go. And I have to bracket this side as well. Cn with the dot is just a number, so we can ignore it as far as the bracket is concerned. There should be an n here. There we go. So there's this. I just bracketed both sides of my differential equation, and I did it on purpose for no other reason that now I have a bracket of two eigenstates, and a bracket of two eigenstates will give you back a Kronecker delta. So this becomes Kronecker Fn. And the nice thing about Kronecker's under summations, it's the same trick that we've been using over and over, is that Kronecker's underneath the summation sign will just single out that one moment that n equals, in this case, f. So there's this. So there you go. By this trick with the bracketing, we now have an expression for Cf with some constants. Let's clean up a little bit. First of all, the epsilons we don't care about, right? They were just a bookkeeping device. They did their bookkeeping. We can throw them away now. Cf dot is here. Let me write it up here. Cf dot, if I look at this expression compared to that one, I can see that it's equal to minus I divided over h bracket psi f, and there's a h1 over there psi I. And now there's two complex factors. This one had one of its own, and I'm going to divide this one out so I get cf. If you just do the math, you will find that it's this. H bar. There you go. Forget about this. We now have an expression for the C bars, which is so close now to the Fermi-Golden rule, because if we have Cf modulo squared, we actually have this number. And you can already see that it is very close already, because, well, look at it. Here's a bracket. That's exactly that bracket. And if you take the modulo square, you will get this modulo square. So already close. Almost there. Well, let's first do the integration, right? I mean, what we have here is it's time derivative. We don't want the time derivative, we want the thing itself. But you know how to get rid of the time derivative. Just take the integral on both sides. So that's what I'm doing right now. Remember, this state and this state were eigenstates of h0, and h0 did not depend on time, and as a result, these do not depend on time. So this whole bracket here is completely time independent. So when I do the integration over time to get rid of the derivative, I can just ignore this part. Just copy it. Integration doesn't do anything with it. In fact, the only thing that the integration does is integrate this thing. But that's easy, right? Integration like this, dt. And this, of course, you can easily write down immediately. Just becomes h minus I EIEF. That's the nice thing about exponentials. They integrate and differentiate so easily. So there we are. Here's an expression for CF. Just did the whole integration in one step. And this also is extremely close to our final answer, because we have CF now. And the only thing I have to do is take CF modulo square and show that it's equal to that number. But we have to go back for a second, because if you recall, when we wrote down how we were going to write down our general state psi, we wrote it as a Kronecker plus these C bars, but the C bars had this one condition to fulfill, namely that C bar F at t equals zero should itself be zero. You might remember that from a while back when we were writing down these things for the first time, that this is a condition that they have to fulfill. It doesn't at this moment, because at the moment when I write down t is zero in this, then this thing becomes unity, but the outcome itself is not zero. So apparently my integration did not give us the right boundary condition back. It doesn't fulfill our initial condition. But this is the moment that you recognize that if you do an integration, you're always free to add a constant, a constant of integration. Call it this. Plus C. Some random number. You're always free to do that. That's the nice thing about integrations. So of course we're going to choose this C in such a way that at the moment that you fill in t is zero, then this C will cancel everything out and everything becomes zero. And it's very easy to see for yourself that one way of doing that is by saying, you know what? It's going to set it equal to minus one. Check this for yourself. At the moment that you now put in t equals zero, the bracket should now be here. There you go. At the moment that you now put in t equals zero, then this exponent becomes unity minus this integration constant gives us exactly zero, and then you have this condition fulfilled. So we're saved now by our constants of integration. Some other teachers here said that those were the best things in mathematics, constant of integration. Here we are. We now have the full expression. Minus one. There you go. That is our expression now for CF. Now, from this moment on, it's just a matter of algebra. Because as advocated before, if you take CF modulo squared, there's the thing, then the interpretation from physics is that this thing is the probability that at the moment that you're now measuring, you will find that the system has gone from state psi I to state psi F. And that's exactly that thing over there. So the only thing that you're left to do, and it's an algebraic exercise, is to show that this thing, modulo squared, is just that thing. Well, part of it you can already see. Because if you take the modulo square of this whole first part, what you would just get is 1 over h bar squared psi f h1 psi I modulo square. Now this part you have to fiddle around a little bit with. But it's very easy to show ultimately that it's going to be equal to this. Again, it's an exercise in algebra. It's not that difficult for people who want to know how to do it. Here's a small hintoid. The sine of x is equal to 1 over 2i. And this combination of complex exponentials. Now, if you use that trick and rewrite this as sines, and you also recognize that you have here an energy difference divided by h bar, which we called omega, and you do the math, you will find exactly that expression over there. So there's that. That's the Fermi golden rule.